Hi everyone! Welcome back to IntegralCalc.com. Today we're going to be talking about how to use the comparison test to determine whether or not a series converges or diverges. And in this particular case, we've been given the function the square root of n divided by n squared plus n, and we need to determine using the comparison test whether or not this series converges or diverges. So to use the comparison test, the first thing we have to realize is that our original series should be called a sub n. We'll call it a sub n. What we need to do in order to use the comparison test is find a second series called b sub n to which we can compare our original series. This is a really great candidate for the comparison test, and the reason is because when you have a fraction like this and you can take the terms from the numerator and denominator that have the greatest effect on the magnitude, you'll be able to find a series b sub n that's similar enough to our original series, but that'll allow us to make some kind of comparison. So what we're talking about here is we've only got one term in the numerator, right? It's the square root of n. So we're gonna go ahead and use this term. And then in the denominator, we've got two terms, n squared and n. We want to take the terms from both the numerator and denominator that have the greatest effect on the magnitude of the function. So n squared is a bigger deal than n, because no matter what number we plug in for n, this part, n squared, is going to be a larger number and change the function more than n by itself would do. So for our comparison series, b sub n, we're going to take those two terms and we're going to say that b sub n is going to be equal to the square root of n divided by n squared. We can go ahead and simplify b sub n. We realize that anything, the square root of n is equal to n to the 1/2 power, right? Those are the same thing. We'll leave n squared alone. Now we can go ahead and simplify this fraction. We'll take 1/2 minus 2, right? Because these things are both raised to the same base, because they both have the base of n, we can subtract the exponents from one another. So we'll do the exponent in the numerator minus the exponent in the denominator, so 1/2 minus 2. What that's going to do is leave us with n to the 3/2 in the denominator. So this is now our simplified b sub n series, or a simplified comparison series. And what we should be able to recognize is that this is a p series, right? Remember that a p series, we've got 1 in the numerator, and we've got a variable raised to an exponent in the denominator. In this case, our exponent, and this is the important part, is 3/2, right? So we've got a p series where p is equal to 3/2. And remember from studying p series that whenever the exponent is larger than 1 or greater than 1, our series converges. So 3/2 is greater than 1, which means the series 1 over n to the 3/2 is going to converge, which means b sub n, our comparison series, converges. Okay, so we know that b sub n converges. When we're using the comparison test, what we need to realize, and I like to think about it in terms of a graph, we need to know whether or not b sub n is smaller or larger, greater or lesser than a sub n, right? And the reason is because, let's talk about b sub n and a sub n in terms of a graph here. So let's say that a sub n is going to be in orange here, and b sub n will be in green. So we've already determined that b sub n converges, right? If b sub n, and these graphs don't represent what the graphs actually look like at all, but I'm just going to say for sake of argument here, that b sub n looks something like this, right? It's going to converge eventually to zero, but it's coming down here toward the x-axis, and it's going to converge toward zero. If a sub n is smaller than or less than b sub n always, then it's always going to be underneath the graph, right? And if b sub n converges, that's going to force a sub n to converge, because b sub n is going to sandwich a sub n in between b sub n and the x-axis, right? As the x-axis comes out this way, right? And b sub n comes closer and closer to the x-axis, it's going to force a sub n right, in between them, giving it a smaller and smaller space. So if B sub n converges and it's larger than A sub n, we prove that A sub n also converges. If, in a different situation, B sub n converges and A sub n is greater than B sub n, then we haven't proved anything, because if A sub n is larger, A sub n might converge, right? But it also might diverge. Maybe the series looks like this, right? And it's larger than B sub n, and we would have no way of knowing if it converges or diverges. So if B sub n converges, we need A sub n to be less than B sub n in order for the test to be conclusive. And if we think about it another way, if B sub n diverges, right? Here's B sub n, and it diverges like this, right? If A sub n is larger than B sub n, we know that it also has to diverge, right? It couldn't converge. If A sub n is less than B sub n, then it could diverge, but it could also converge like this, and it would be inconclusive. So let's just remember here that B sub n converges, B sub n diverges, and if A sub n is less than B sub n here, the test is inconclusive. If A sub n is greater than B sub n in the first example, the test is inconclusive. So what this tells us is that when B sub n converges, we need A sub n to be smaller than B sub n. And when B sub n diverges, we need A sub n to be larger than B sub n in order for the test to be conclusive. So since we already know that B sub n converges, we're looking at this example here, the first example, and we need A sub n to be smaller than B sub n. So that's a lot to say that let's determine whether or not A sub n is smaller or larger than B sub n. So we'll go ahead and erase this and use the space that we've got here. So what we need to do is go ahead and start determining whether or not B sub n is larger than A sub n or vice versa. Because we've got a square root here for n in our A sub n series, we'll go ahead and evaluate both series at 1, 4, and 9, because we know we can take the square roots of those numbers easily. And we'll evaluate at A sub n, and we'll evaluate at B sub n. So we can see here, if we draw our table, we'll get some different values going. So if we evaluate A sub n at 1, right, we'll get the square root of 1 divided by 1 squared plus 1, which is just going to give us 1 over 2. So we'll get 1 half here. If we evaluate A sub n at 4, we'll get 2 divided by 16 plus 4, which is going to be 2 over 20. So 2 over 20 or 1 tenth. Oops, 2 over 20 or 1 tenth. And then if we evaluate at 9, we'll get 3 divided by 81 plus 9, gives us 90. So we'll get 3 over 90, which is the same as 1 over 30. If we go ahead and plug the same values into B sub n, right? B sub n, remember, is this series right here, 1 over n to the 3 halves. So if we plug in 1, we'll get 1 over 1, which is going to give us 1. If we plug in 4, we'll get 1 over the, basically it's the square root of 4 cubed, which is going to be 1 over 2 cubed, which is 1 over 8. So we get 1 eighth. And if we plug in 9, we'll get 1 over the square root of 9 cubed, which is going to be 1 over 3 cubed, which is equal to 1 over 27. So we've got 1 over 27 here. So what we can see is that A sub n is always going to be smaller than B sub n, right? 1 is greater than 1 half, 1 eighth is greater than 1 tenth, and 1 27th is greater than 1 30th. So we've concluded that B sub n will always be larger than a sub n, and we've shown as well that neither of these series will ever be negative. So we know that they're both greater than zero, which is what we needed to determine, right? We needed to show here for the comparison test that b sub n was greater than a sub n, which was greater than zero. And that's a good thing because now a sub n, right, is down here, which is in the section of the graph where we can draw a conclusion. Because b sub n is converging, we needed a sub n to be smaller than b sub n in order to draw a conclusion. Since b sub n converges and a sub n is always less than b sub n, we've proven that a sub n also must converge, right? Which is this part right here. When this is true, that b sub n is greater than a sub n greater than zero, and we know that b sub n converges, which we already do because we know from the p series, 3 halves is greater than 1, and therefore b sub n converges, that a sub n also must converge. So that's it. I hope this video helped you guys, and I will see you in the next one.